Hello, and welcome to the Chiaroscuro Jazz Podcast. I'm George Graham, Director of Artistry and Repertoire for the venerable jazz label, which for over a half century has been presenting music from some of the world's great jazz musicians. In this series, we'll have conversations with some of today's outstanding players and their thoughts on some of the artists who've recorded for Chiaroscuro. This time, it's a conversation with drummer and bandleader Sherrie Maricle. For over 30 years, she has led the Diva Orchestra, an all-women ensemble who played all over the world and at venues such as Carnegie Hall, the Kennedy Center, the Hollywood Bowl, plus jazz festivals from Bonn, Germany to Bogota, Colombia. With a doctorate from New York University, Dr. Maricle also leads spin-off group 3D Jazz Trio. She brings a fascinating perspective to jazz and talks about the role of women in music. I began by asking her how she got started down her swinging career path.
I love the story. It's not very dramatic or anything, but when I was a kid, I went to see Buddy Rich and his Killer Force in 1974. I was 11 years old. I sat up in the balcony. I didn't know what jazz was. I didn't really know what a big band was. And I remember Buddy's band. It was at the Forum in Binghamton, New York. Great theater there. I grew up in that area, Endicott, New York. And Buddy's band came out and they were all in tuxedos and, you know, everybody's kind of waiting. Then Buddy comes out in a black t-shirt. He starts his quintessential way he would start the band with just a groove on the hi-hat. And the band started playing and my entire body, I felt like I was being struck by lightning and electrocuted by angels or something. I don't know what, every hair on my body was on end. I had so much adrenaline coursing through my system and I have loved it ever since then. And I remember running home to my mother and telling my mother, Mom, I don't know what jazz is. I have to play the drums and I have to be a jazz drummer. And she thought I was insane. You know, no clue what I was talking about whatsoever. But it was just like that. It was like being struck by lightning, like, oh, wow. Now I never have to think about anything that I want to do because this is what I want to do.
Wow. A real epiphany right there at the start.
It was. And I get whenever anybody asks me that, I get actually just the same kind of surge of happiness, remembering that moment so vividly because it was so spectacular. And there's no, you know, Buddy Rich was just a force, you know. Then flash forward a million years later, when I met Stanley Kaye, who formed the Diva Jazz Orchestra, knowing that he was the manager of the Buddy Rich Band. Oh. So it's kind of this weird, you know, very, I don't know, serendipitous circle of, I don't think it was a coincidence.
Right, right. It's sort of destiny there. Tell us about your background and your evolution from being a fan of Buddy Rich into a professional jazz musician.
Okay. Well, I always had an interest in music. And I remember my father would take me to like the Endicott, New York and Binghamton, New York, like Halloween parades or holiday parades. And I always loved the marching bands. I did always really like the drums and the drum line, but I wanted to play music. And I remember in elementary school, fourth grade, getting around that same, I forgot how old I was in fourth grade, but I remember I really wanted to play the trumpet. And the teacher declared that girls couldn't play the trumpet. Which, you know, people still say that kind of crazy stuff today, but as if instruments have a gender. But anyway, I was given a metal clarinet, didn't like it, simultaneously studied the cello, had some ups and downs and arguments with my then teachers. Even as a young kid, I knew what I wanted to do and I wasn't being allowed to do it. So anyway, I made it all the way to sixth grade and still stayed in the bands. And somebody, the band director, said he needed some extra people in the percussion section to do something. And I volunteered and I went back there and then I never left. So that's sort of where I stayed in school, but and didn't really start playing. My mom got me my first drum set. It was a gold sparkle drum set. Probably, I don't think we got it from Walmart, but it was one of those kind of a kid sets. And I wish I still had it actually today because it was cool when I see little pictures of myself like that set. But I really started playing jazz in high school and I was nervous to join the high school jazz ensemble. I don't know, because there was no girls really. There's a few young women in it, but nobody ever really played the drums, you know. So I was nervous. And I remember the band director vividly, again, one of those moments, he said something like, with affection, like, what are you stupid? Don't be ridiculous. Of course audition. You know, like, which is one of those moments that if he would have said no, I mean, who knows, could have like delayed me a bit, but you never think of those, like, just off the cuff, he just said, what are you stupid? Of course you can audition. So got in the jazz ensemble, and then I was always in marching band, and just, I played everything all the time, music, 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 music. I ended up graduating from high school 1 year early, and I went to Ithaca College, which was nearby town, socially not prepared for that at all, but I wanted to go there because, Gordon Stout was the percussion teacher, and he's one of the world's most revered solo marimba players, solo marimbas, and, just a great percussionist. And so I went there, and I was about 16, and I was just socially not prepared for that. And for some reason my roommates were two seniors, which really didn't work out well at all. But anyway, I left Ithaca. I still remain really good friends with Gordon. And I ended up at Binghamton University, which really always in the hindsight, and very quickly it came to me especially after I moved to New York, I grew up with such a blessed environment of music. So I went to Binghamton University, which is then still just called SUNY Binghamton then. And prior to that, Harper College, which is a liberal arts school where the music department was. Amazing jazz program. Drinking age was 18, so there was a campus pub. The big band played every night at the campus, or every Monday at the campus pub. And just, we played all over the community and all over the town. I played every single musical, everything anyone asked me to play. I just played continuously. And Al Hom, who recently passed away, was the chairman of the music department. And he was one of my mentors. And he just gave me so many opportunities when he trusted that I was up to snuff, so to speak. He started hiring me for his professional big band called Music Unlimited that worked like absolutely like crazy. His dance band called Swing Street. We had a steady gig at the Ramada Inn playing a dance swing music, big band swing, like once a week. Amazing. And then I played all the Ringling Brothers circuses, all the Ice Capades, if you remember that, all the shows that came through, it was called the Binghamton Arena. I played so much, and I was so great. Like, you could never pay for that opportunity. No matter how much money you had, you could not pay for that level of experience I got in all those different genres of music. And also up there, jazz wise, the great bassist Slam Stewart lived there.
Binghamton,
New York. So I played with him. I remember the first time playing with him, I was very speechless. And I was like, but you played with Benny Goodman, and you played Sing 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 with Gene Krupa, and you played on the record with Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie. That's considered the bridge between swing and bebop. And you this. And he was so nice and so humble. He used to play the bass, and I would practice. I would play on a placemat on his dining room table if we were going to rehearse something. But well, that was amazingly transformative in that time period. Like, in the late 70s and early 80s, I was doing a lot of that. I was in a couple of wedding bands, making so much money. Now you may all think this is funny, but way back then in the early 80s, we were in these wedding bands. We'd be playing like 3 and 4 gigs a week without fail, making $300 or $400. And that's like the standard today, right now in 2023, but we were making it as kids. I was just talking to one of my friends from that era about this. And I said, am I making that up, or do we really make that much money? Because remember, I always felt really rich. It was really great. I'm incredibly grateful for that. And then Slam Stewart brought all these great musicians to the university. He was sort of a artist in residence there. And I mean, I don't know, Zoot Sims and Clark Terry and just the slew of like the great traditional jazz players were always there. And Slam had a bathroom in his house. His address was 80 Chestnut Street in Binghamton. I actually wrote a song for him called that. But in his bathroom, he had all the musicians that came to town signed the bathroom wall.
Oh.
And I remember right above the toilet tank, Clark Terry wrote, best seat in the house, with a big arrow. You know, stuff like that. It was so great.
It's typically Clark. And with Slam, did he do his bowing and humming thing with you?
Oh, my gosh, yeah. Yeah, we had a big duet we used to do in concert on the Big Noise from Winnetka.
Mm-hmm.
The two of us, his version, and it was so funny. And I remember one, he's like, well, I'm going to hum because I don't really whistle that well. But we would try to whistle and then my mouth would get dry because I was nervous and couldn't whistle. So then we would just stare at each other and start laughing, like on the concert. But it would be, I would bring like my floor tom and a bunch of little percussion instruments to the front of the stage and just stand right next to him. And I have my cassette tape version of, you know, a couple of performances with him. And yeah, but really so kind and nurturing. And I just put this on social media the other day. I found a picture of my first professional record date was Slam's Last.
Oh, mm-hmm.
And it was a record. It was in 1986. It was called, it was called The Cats Are Swinging. And Major Holly, bass player, came in and finished the recording. Mm. But that was with Richard Wyans on piano and Bucky Pizzarelli and Slam. And the mentor I mentioned of mine, Al Hamm, and Peter Appleyard, one of the greatest vibes players ever. I don't know if you're familiar with him.
Yes, Canadian.
Mm-hmm. So great. They were all on this record, and we did it at Clinton Recording Studios in New York. And I talk about a crazy experience. When, again, being like in that situation as such a, you know, just in my youth, just getting so much experience and just being in that envelope of that greatness was just nothing like it. Nothing you can get anywhere else except to live through something like that and have that experience.
Before Diva got organized, did you have your own groups, or this was just a continuation of the sort of side projects or the various things that got put together?
When I was ready to decided I had to move to New York, I was just going to move there. I just wanted to play jazz, and I took out a $5,000 loan. Again, my parents thought I was insane. My father was telling me I'm going to get murdered, and you know, it was like on and on. And at Binghamton University, there was a concert, and it was Bob Brookmeyer and Joe Lovano and Adam Nussbaum and Michael Moore and Jim McNeely on piano, an array of jazz stars. And I started talking to them, and Michael Moore said to me, oh, I teach at this school called NYU, and we're just like really kicking up the jazz program. Why don't you check it out? I didn't know what NYU was, had no idea what New York University was. But I love Michael Moore. I was like, oh, okay. So I went down to NYU and in the Village, 35 West 4th Street, and I auditioned for the school. I got a scholarship. And when I finished my master's degree, which like blew by so fast because it was just, I never studied in school where it was just all jazz all the time, every minute. So it was like the best 3 semesters of my life. And then they offered me a doctoral fellowship, which I didn't want. I never thought about it, but it was a teaching fellow. So it paid money. And I was like, oh, well, then I know I have to worry about my rent if I accept this. That, you know, some people get really offended when I say that, but that is the reason that I have a doctorate. When I had to do the work. But I mean, I was motivated to do it because I was offered this money for 3 years. And I was like, well, my God, what a gift that is.
Yeah.
So while I was at NYU, I wanted to freelance, and I, you know, worked hard to try to get in Broadway. I was in a couple of another wedding bands were still big back then. Before I even moved to New York, I started playing a little bit with, they were called Emery and Meyer Davis. They were like a Lester Lannan type, you know, society band, a big band with no music. I mean, the horn players, there was that the kind of band it was. It was amazing. And then I got through this NYU, I got the job of running the jam session at the Village Gate on Bleecker Street every Saturday from two in the afternoon to six on the terrace. For 8 years I did that. Wow. Until Art Dlugoff lost his lease. That was like life-changing. Every Saturday, just right on Bleecker Street with the terrace level, and just amazing musicians came there. And then I was at a jazz festival this past weekend, and Gerald Cannon was playing with Eddie Henderson and George Gables and a few other great players. And I was like, Gerald Cannon, I saw you like 40 years ago, man, remember? And he was laughing. He's like, wow, 40 years ago. But that's like how you remember people, from those pivotal moments when you're really young and like trying to figure it out. And that was something, I mean, besides a lot of other great things I got from NYU, that was pretty amazing. And to study with the great Mel Lewis, who, you know, I mean, a couple of times I played the third set at the Vanguard with his band as my lesson.
With Thad? Thad Jones?
But no, it was just when it was the Mel Lewis Jazz Orchestra.
Okay. This was after Thad passed away.
Yeah, but I'll tell you, that's talk about, you have to be ready for that. I don't know if I was ready, but Mel, and it was that's when all the clubs used to still do three sets. That was the standard, like in the Blue Note, they were all three sets, but Mel would be like, Sherrie, go up, because I went every Monday, and he'd go up there and play. And I'd be like, okay. And it'd be the first, you know, the third set. And I was luckily everybody was, you know, probably a little tipsy because it was the third set. Because, you know, and he'd be yelling things, Sherrie, play louder. Sherrie, switch to this cymbal. Sherrie, do that. Meanwhile, you know, the band is giving me a hard time. And it was a great experience. And yeah, Mel showed me. Mel was amazing. A big influence, a big band playing and otherwise. And it's one of the things when you get older, it's like Mel Lewis was 60 when he died. Hmm. 60.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable. Yeah. I just turned 60. Hmm. So that's like a crazy it's I don't know if perspective is the correct word, but it's just, he always seemed so old to me when I was his student, and he clearly was, he really wasn't, you know. But yeah, that was an extraordinary time. And I studied at NYU with Mel Lewis and Adam Nussbaum, and took a semester of vibes lessons from Dave Samuels. And just like, I got to study with a lot of amazing musicians who really, you know, kicked my butt left and right and helped me so much. And, you know, told me the things I needed to hear, even if I didn't want to. And it was great. And I'm still really close friends with Adam Nussbaum, and he was a great influence on me as well. And it was great. It was amazing to live in New York. I like to tell all the, or I teach right now at some drum lessons at the University of the Arts in Philadelphia. And sometimes these kids, like, there's really no place for them to go on a consistent basis that's even reasonably affordable. But I mean, when I was, I definitely sound like an old lady. The Vanguard was $5. And, you know, the Blue Note had a jam session every night after the third set. And I lived up the block and I went every single night. It would be like 2 a.m. to 4 every night. Wow. Free. You know, like that's, and I know then the generations before me talk about Swing Street and there was music until 8 a.m. and then there was breakfast jams and then there was this and that. Like, I just hope the young people pursuing careers in this field have those opportunities. And I don't know about them because I'm old. I hope.
Well, I think one thing about the current generation is there are more educational opportunities, more formal educational opportunities than there were back in the day. Now, of course, you had pretty good formal education, but, you know, when jazz musicians were coming up, the road was their school.
Yeah, and that was my big dream was to go on the road with Woody Herman.
Oh.
And I love that band so much. I love their music and their arrangements, and it was a great variety of originals and standards, and it was, you know, really cool. I mean, he had so many great drummers in that band. Jeff Hamilton, and just, I mean, every, you know, I don't know. Jeff was a teacher of mine as well, and one of my very favorite drummers of all time. So I think I sent in my cassette tape when I was in college so that people could pass it around the Woody Herman bus to see if I would have a chance. And my colleague of mine on the bus said, you know what, everybody listened to it and they liked the drumming. But then when they said, oh, it's a young woman, they're like, hell no, no way, forget it. You know, and I you know, just, road rats haven't evolved that much. Now it's different. Now, but there also aren't any touring big bands like that anymore.
Right.
Now, right. To that extent where the band would stay on the road 300 days a year, like Woody and Maynard and Buddy and all those groups did that consistently. And that's what I wanted to do.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, it wasn't an easy
play and play and play.
It was not an easy life.
No, and I remember Woody Herman's band being in residence at Binghamton University for a week, and they would pay like four guys in a room, you know, and just like, you know, live like that. So they didn't have, because they had to pay for their own rooms, and then they got reimbursed for some of it, but they just wanted to save money. So they were all just always in the same, you know, four or five people in a room. But when you're 20, it's like fun. Wouldn't be fun now.
Yeah, right. Well, with your big band experience, I guess that sort of leads up to Stanley Kaye and his founding of the Diva Orchestra.
Yeah, you know, this is another magical night in my life, because I was playing at the 75th anniversary of the Schubert Theater in New Haven, Connecticut in May of 1990. And Skitch Henderson, the famous pianist and I think he was one of the the Tonight Show conductors,
Yeah, right.
He was conducting the orchestra. The orchestra was contracted by a great musician named Sonny Costanzo, who played trombone, and he actually played in Clark's Big Bad Band. But he was a wonderful guy too, and so he hired me for many things. And I'm playing along, and in comes Stanley Kaye with Maurice Hines as a guest artist as part of this 75th anniversary. And I was like to myself, "That's Stanley Kaye. That's the manager from the Buddy Rich Band." So I was really nervous, and he was kind of conducting a bit for Maurice, you know, like Dizzy Gillespie conducting, a lot of like moving around. And the music was so great. Like that whole Maurice Hines library and Hines, Hines and Dad swing, like a bunch of Al Cohen charts, like so swinging. So I was having like the time of my life because that was the only really thing on the show that was like that. And I made it a point to talk to Stanley at the reception. And before I get to the rest of Stanley's story, just very briefly, I love Skitch Henderson too, because I thought he was really cool. And he was leaving the stage door, and he didn't seem like he really loved the orchestra that much, but I, honest to God, like I pulled on his trench coat belt so he didn't leave. And I was like, Mr. Henderson, my maestro Henderson, I love working with you. Thank you so much for everything, you know? And he whirled around and he goes, you! And his talk about her, he's got a great radio voice. He would have been a great podcaster with his voice. He goes, you, I want you to come play with the New York Pops. And I really thought he was kidding. I was like, oh, sure. You know, like, no way. So the new, but anyway, that was in May. In August, he called me up and he said, I'm going to offer you the season, but you can't miss any. You can't miss a single concert. They have the orchestra still to this day has a concert, a series at Carnegie Hall. So anyway, I got the job and I stayed there for 32 years.
Wow.
In that orchestra. But that was from that one concert. You know, isn't that amazing? And I thought, oh, sure. Like he's, you know, a lot of people are like, yeah, I'll call you. But he called me and my first gig was with the orchestra was the Columbus Avenue Street Fair. The New York Post sponsored. And there was no rehearsal. It's like a huge orchestra on the street. And I knew one person in the orchestra. I'm like, help me, man. Is this section repeated? Like what's happening? And he goes, I don't know. So it's almost like a jazz gig, but with a symphony orchestra. It was kind of hilarious. But then with that orchestra, I got to go to Japan multiple times in Korea and record like amazing music and multiple times on the NBC fireworks and just such amazing, amazing work. And to every time to be in Carnegie Hall with an orchestra like that, absolutely amazing. So yeah, so that was from that night I met Skitch and that clearly changed my life. And then, so 2 years after that, about in 92, Stanley Kay called. We were friendly and talking on the phone and I invited him to my gigs here and there. But he said, I have an idea. First of all, how come there's no women playing in any of the big bands I see in New York? And he was referring to Mel Lewis's band and Toshiko Akiyoshi's band then had a steady gig at a club called Lush Life. Anyhow, there's all these wonderful bands working. And Stanley said, how come there's no women in these bands? Are there women that play like you? I said, there are women like me everywhere that play like, I gotta play their ass off, so to speak, you know? And I don't know. It's like one of those social condition things. Like, if there's a woman on the list, you know, we're going to call her last out of desperation, you know, for no reason other than social conditioning. So he said, well, Stanley was working a lot in theater and working with Maurice Hines, had a couple of shows on Broadway. And Stanley also managed Gregory Hines for a number of years. And he was actually the entertainment director for the New York Yankees, which was an interesting kind of strange job. He worked directly for the Steinbrenner family, but also for all the players and events and things at the stadium. And that's how Buddy Rich got into Yankee Stadium because of that relationship. But anyhow, Stanley said, I want to get back in the band business. I want to try this. I want to have a band of all women. I remember the Sweethearts of Rhythm, but that's all I can think of. Are there women that, you know, again, that play like you? I said, yeah. So let's have an audition. He goes, I'm telling you the truth. I'm going to get together. I'm getting Michael LaBenny. I'm getting John LaBarbera. He's getting all of his friends from the Buddy Rich days that did all the composing and arranging for Buddy. He said, we're going to audition for 3 days. If it sounds good, we'll keep going. If it's not good, it's over right there. And I said, okay. So 40 people came to the original audition, Jet Carroll Music Studios in New York. And yeah, we picked the original. Well, it was actually 17 people at the beginning, the very first rendition of Diva. And but Ingrid Jensen was in that band. Liesl Whitaker, who still is our lead trumpet player. And Laura Dreyer, who was playing many multitudes of saxophone chairs, but she's also back in the first tenor chair. So, and many people in Diva have been with us like 20, 25 plus years. It's got a lot of longevity. So the first Stanley's vision first was he wanted a band, somebody to front the band that was sort of like a Dizzy Gillespie type character, you know, I mean a character in an entertainment sense, somebody that would entertain the audience and not be all serious, you know, faced musicians on stage. So we had a vocalist named Elisa Geis, who was in Miss Saigon on Broadway, a great singer, but jazz really wasn't necessarily her forte. So we did a couple of gigs with her and then that kind of fizzled away. We had a guitar player originally And then even doing a couple of gigs, it was like, you know, trying to save money. So out went the guitar, unfortunately. And then Stanley said he was talking to Maurice Hines about it. And he said, oh, who are we going to get to lead? This is like very, not even within the first, you know, few months, who are we going to get to lead this band? And Maurice said, well, my God, your leader's right there. She's sitting at the drums, get her. And that's how I took over the helm with Stanley, you know. And then, yeah. And as the band is, you know, evolved, you can imagine, you know, we clearly, I'm sure we could, but we don't necessarily need to talk about all the women in jazz things that happen, you know, because women in jazz never think of the women part. We only think of the jazz part, but right. There's still a lot of, you know, well, we have a woman band on this year's festival, Atlantic Records. No, we don't want you. We have a woman band. Like about Diva, like just hearing things like nothing to do with the music at all. So still astonishing even then, but I know people still say things like that now. But
I think that the women's profile in jazz is certainly coming up in recent years. I mean, the success of Artemis is a good example, who have a couple of Diva alumni in that group.
Yeah.
Ingrid Jensen.
Yep. And well, and Anat Cohen.
Yes.
Who spent 10 years with Diva. And Nicole Glover, who's in there now, she played with us quite a number of times. She's extraordinary. And Alexan Tarantino, who was in Artemis for a minute, who's now playing with Winton's band. And now in Artemis is Erica von Kleist, who's played with Diva. I met her when she was in high school. So she's played on a number of recordings with us. And yeah, there's the profile is going up. A lot of young women I hear and get emails and things through our website, young women in college. And they're like, oh, my God, please help me. With things of like, frankly, you know, their teachers hitting on them and they're put in situations where it's like still to this day, women are feeling like, but if I'm too strong and reject them, then they'll, you know, blackball me and no one will hire me. I mean, that's like still kind of some of the vibe, which is hard to believe, but it still happens, you know. And I mean, like this year, you know, people, there never a year goes by where I'm not hearing from a handful of young women asking, what should I do? You know, but thankfully since the Me Too movement though, young women are really using their voices a lot more aggressively, and enough teachers in higher ed academia in music departments have been, you know, let go or confronted with their behavior. And it's really changed. It's changed a lot. So as long as we all, especially if men and teachers and will encourage women to, you know, have that power too, I think it'll just even the playing field even more. You know, because I don't know if any young man has ever been, I'm not going to go as far as a threat, either real threat or perceived threat of like, hey, you know, I'll never call you because you're a bitch, you know, basically. Like, I don't know if young men have ever experienced that, but probably, but I haven't really heard from any of them. But I think that this is all, to your point, George, like the women's profiles are going up. And I think part of that is just, you know, just finding your own voice and confidence to be strong enough to say, you know what, just please just pay attention to how I play the music. That's all.
Yeah.
And I think that's happening. Not to bring a serious tone to this fun podcast, but well, which is on a side note, Chiaroscuro used to do the SS Norway jazz cruise a number of times. Didn't Chiaroscuro always have a record live
yes.
there or have
right.
a presence there? Mm-hmm. I always remember seeing the sign and everything.
Yeah.
Roaming around there. Yeah. That's what was fun.
Yeah. And, Hank O'Neill and John Bates were there recording for, yeah, we have a whole bunch of albums that came out of those cruises with Bill Charlap and Phil Woods for one, you know, quite a few others.
Well, you know, Phil Woods, clearly one of the great voices in music, and he too, when I was a kid, I was at a jazz camp and he was one of the instructors, and then, you know, years later when I bought my house up in near the Delaware Water Gap in East Stroudsburg, PA. Of course, Phil lived there, and I got to play on a festival with him. And I reminded him about when I was a teenager, how he screamed at me to stop rushing, and he cracked up laughing. I was like, but he was so just so gifted, like on stage. There was nothing that I'm thinking of the word power, but I mean it to be deeper than that. Just the how profound he was when he played. Just music flowed through him like crazy. You know, then everybody, Michael Moore, when I got a chance to do my first record as a band leader, I immediately hired Michael. And it was a very suspicious label that to this day makes me unhappy. that aside, I got Michael Moore and the great Peter Appleyard, the vibes player, and Roger Kellaway were like always just some of my favorite players played on this record. And there's nothing like playing with Michael. So any record he's on, I know is going to swing like crazy and be beautiful and sensitive, full of groove. He's quite extraordinary. And same would be said of, I got to play with Bucky Pizzarelli a number of times over the years, and he was also just a powerhouse of groove and time. Like if you can't play with him, you can't play with anybody. And such, one of the things I learned a lot from players like Slam and Bucky and just the joy that they had, and Clark Terry especially, my goodness, Clark Terry, wow, those guys, you know, they and Major Holly, they just brought happiness to the stage at all times, and they were entertainers, and I've always viewed myself that way too. It's like you can be as virtuosic as anybody that ever lived, but to me, we still have to be entertainers. I want to bring people happiness, and I learned a lot from that just that attitude of what to bring to the stage and share with your audience from all of them, and their playing is this exemplary of what it means to swing hard and be a great band leaders, great bandmates, and great entertainers. I loved all of them.
Right, and you also mentioned Roger Kellaway, who's another artist who has recorded for Chiaroscuro.
My jaw was on the floor more often than with almost anybody I've ever heard play. He's so prolific. I got so creative and unexpectedly creative. Like on this first record of mine, I mentioned, it's called A Cooking on All Burners, but actually Peter Appleyard. Anyway, so Roger, we played Scrapple from the Apple really fast. And Roger's like, I'll take some choruses by myself. It's really fast. And we get to like, whap to the downbeat. And Roger like takes off. And it was just like, whoa, like astoundingly incredible. And I used to go to the club in New York called Zeno's, an Italian restaurant. And Roger was always playing there with Michael. And I'd Slam Stewart used to play there too a lot, but I used to go and I always really enjoyed hearing things without drums. I was like, hey, wait, they don't need the drums to swing. And it was amazing. But Roger Kellaway and Michael Moore were in there a lot. And Roger with Jay Lenhart also, who I adore. Jay, so I used to get just a lot of happiness out of hearing them do their duo stuff at Zeno's. Yeah. Amazing. Yeah, well, this year, Chiaroscuro is it is incredibly, it's so important, you know, to me, for someone who's a consumer of the music, just to have those things captured that are really deeply, deeply rooted in the tradition with their own sense of, making things a little, modern as they progress, so to speak, with harmony and other kinds of ideas. But it's just the deep roots in the tradition are really important. And that's why I think it's so valuable.
Join us next time as we continue our conversation with Sherrie Maricle. She'll talk about more of her experiences with the Diva Orchestra and other groups and her role as an educator. You can find more information about Dr. Maricle at divajazz.com. Let's go out with a Chiaroscuro recording with Roger Kellaway, Michael Moore, and Gene Bertoncini. This is When Lights Are Low. Thank you. When Lights Are Low, performed by pianist Roger Kellaway, bassist Michael Moore, and guitarist Gene Bertoncini on the Chiaroscuro release, Roger Kellaway meets the duo. You can find information on this and over 100 other titles on Chiaroscuro on our website at chiaroscurojazz.org, where you can find more of these podcasts. And why not subscribe to the Chiaroscuro podcasts wherever you get your podcasts? Join us next time for more from drummer and bandleader Sherrie Maricle. This is George Graham, your producer for the Chiaroscuro podcast series. Our co-producer is Jim Della Croce. Thanks for joining us.